This is PT73, Section 2, Number 4, which is freely available at familiar.lsac.org. You can pause the video, try the problem on your own, and then come back when you're done. This is a problem the LSAT would consider to be quite straightforward, so I hope you found it easy. But whether you got it right or wrong, let's make sure we understand how to break it down so we can see how the concepts underlying this problem will recur in harder problems. The question prompt is telling us that we're going to get a principle in the stimulus, and then we want to pick the answer that most closely conforms to that principle. So let's start off by understanding what that principle is. So here's how I've broken down the principle. We're talking about a situation where an executive salary is determined by advice of an external consultant. And now here's the rule. If that consultant has a business interest with the company that the executive manages, then we can conclude that that executive is likely to be overcompensated, likely to be overpaid. So because we're looking for an answer choice that conforms to this principle, what we want is an answer choice where it gives us premises that match this part, premises that tell us there's an executive whose compensation is determined by a consultant with business interests with that company. And then we want that answer choice's conclusion to say, therefore, that executive is likely to be overcompensated. And that's all that we're looking for. So let's take a look. Answer choice A should be out pretty quickly because did you notice that the conclusion says, therefore, the president's definitely overpaid? But the stimulus's principle only allowed us to conclude that the executive was likely to be overpaid. So answer choice A's conclusion is too strong. And in any case, where's the external consultant? Answer choice A is not even about the situation that we're talking about. Answer choice B starts off okay because the conclusion is that the executive is probably overpaid, which matches likely because likely means probably. But the rest of answer choice B goes completely wrong. Where's the external consultant? Where's the business interest? Answer choice B is not talking about the situation that this principle is about. And so if you are at all tempted by answer choice B, that's probably because you're bringing in just outside understandings of how if a CEO is paid 40 times more than the average employee, then that's somehow overpaid. But that isn't anywhere in this principle, so you can't pick answer choice B based on your real-world understandings. If you have a good understanding of conditional logic, you should be able to get rid of answer choice C very, very quickly, just from the very first two lines, because the conclusion is that the executive is probably not overpaid. But all we can conclude is that the executive likely is overpaid. We could never conclude the negation of the necessary condition. We can never conclude the negation of the right side of a conditional arrow. So C should be out without even needing to read the rest of the answer choice. So what about answer choice D? Well, let's take a look. We have an external consultant who is determining the pay of a president. We know that that external consultant has many other contracts with the company, so that's a business interest that the executive has, or rather that the consultant has with that company. And then we have the right kind of conclusion, therefore, probably overpaid. So likely means probably. That means answer choice D is correct. And answer choice E is something we should also be able to get rid of just from the very first two lines because it says not overpaid as the conclusion, but all we can conclude is that someone is overpaid. To me, the biggest takeaway from this problem is how quickly we should be able to get rid of answer choice C and answer choice E because they are both trying to say that someone is not overpaid as the conclusion when all we can conclude is that someone is overcompensated. So if you had any amount of trouble getting rid of answer choice C or answer choice E or felt like you had to read the entire answer choices to really be sure about them, then I think it would help to get a better understanding of if and then, of sufficient conditions and necessary conditions. So this principle is just saying that this is one situation where we can say that the executive is likely to be overcompensated. But this is not necessarily the only way that we can conclude an executive is likely to be overcompensated. There could be a whole bunch of other reasons that they're overcompensated. For example, maybe the executive does no work and that makes them likely to be overcompensated. Or maybe the executive gets billions of dollars after mass layoffs, like what happened with WeWork, and maybe then we could say the executive's overcompensated. Or maybe the only reason the executive has a job is nepotism, and that makes them overcompensated. So because these possibilities exist, and maybe a dozen other possibilities, maybe there's an infinite number of other possibilities that would allow us to reach this conclusion, that's why we cannot say that if an executive salary is not determined by an external consultant, that that means they're not overcompensated. That's why we can't say that if the external consultant doesn't have a business interest, that this means the executive's not overcompensated. So the big takeaway is that we cannot conclude that someone is not overcompensated. We can only conclude that they likely are overcompensated. Next up, let's take a look at PT 73, Section 4, Number 23, available at familiar.lsac.org. Pause the video, try it on your own, and come back when you're finished. So this is an extremely tough problem, and most people are going to have a really tough time with it. However, if you really understand the meaning of accept, and also paid attention to the mental state aspect of this principle, the belief aspect of this principle, then this problem actually could have been very, very straightforward. So let's see how we might break it down. The prompt is telling us that there's going to be a principle in the stimulus that we want to apply to these answer choices. The correct answer is going to validly apply the principle. There's also going to be a problem that is basically a set of facts. So what we want to do is we want to understand the facts, we want to understand the principle, and then let's pick the answer that validly uses the principle. This is a visualization about the situation the problem describes. Basically, Daniel won an award, and if Shayna says congratulations, well, she'd be a big fat liar because she, for some reason, doesn't actually think she should congratulate him. Maybe she thinks Daniel doesn't deserve the award. Maybe she thinks she deserved the award over him. Or maybe Daniel got a participation trophy. Maybe Shayna thinks it's an award that just doesn't really matter, is nothing to be proud about. We don't really know why. But if she says congratulations, she'd be lying about her feelings. And if she doesn't say anything, though, then Daniel's going to be really hurt. Now we get to the principle, which basically is, don't misrepresent your feelings. Now we'll get to that exception in a moment. The general rule that we should follow is don't misrepresent your feelings. Now, what does that mean about Shayna's situation? If you're not supposed to misrepresent your feelings, and saying congratulations would be a misrepresentation, then if we follow this rule, we should be able to conclude that Shayna should not say congratulations to Daniel because that's going to be a misrepresentation. But there is an exception to this overall rule. It might be okay to misrepresent your feelings as long as you think that the person you're talking to prefers kindness over the truth. Or in other words, it might be okay for Shayna to say congratulations if she thinks that Daniel wants kindness over the truth. Now, you don't have to diagram this principle if you feel like you really understand what it means and you know what it means for something to be an exception. But if you feel like it would help you understand what's going on, here's an example of how you might think of the diagram. The idea of an exception is just like the word unless. It's just like the word without. It's saying that unless you are in this situation, unless you are in this exception, then don't misrepresent your feelings. And so we can do with the word accept the same thing that we do with the word unless, which is we take whatever the unless is applying to and we make that the sufficient condition, but we negate it. If you don't believe that the person wants kindness over the truth, then here's the rule that applies. You should not misrepresent your feelings. Since I'm looking for an answer choice that validly uses this principle, I'm looking for an answer where the premise part is she does not believe Daniel wants kindness over truth, and the conclusion is, therefore, she should not misrepresent her feelings, or in other words, she should not say congratulations. That is basically all I'm looking for. By the way, I do want to note that technically there is another kind of answer that we could anticipate that could be correct, and that's going to come from the contrapositive. And so here I've drawn out the contrapositive, and it says that if it's okay to misrepresent her feelings, or in other words, if you negate should not misrepresent, which in other words is if she should misrepresent or if it's okay to misrepresent, then that must mean that Daniel thinks, or rather Shayna believes, Daniel wants kindness over truth. So if we had an answer where the premise gave us this part, fact, Shayna can say congratulations, or it's okay for Shayna to say congratulations, and then conclusion, therefore Shayna must believe that Daniel wants kindness over truth, that could be a correct answer too, because that would validly use this principle. But in my experience, this is not going to be likely, because generally speaking, it's about the judgment, about what you should or should not do. The conclusion is going to be about what you should or should not do. So I'm going to be focused on this way of understanding the principle. I'm not going to be focused on this way where the judgment is on the left side. Now let's take a look at these answer choices. And the great thing about this question is if you really understood that this problem is about what Shayna believes, about what she believes about Daniel's preference, then the first four answer choices can be gotten rid of very, very confidently, because none of them tell us what Shayna thinks about what Daniel wants. The only one that comes kind of close is answer choice C. Answer choice C says that Shayna believes that kindness should be preferred to dishonesty, but that's just a general statement about what Shayna believes should be preferred. That's not a belief about what Daniel thinks. So that's why you can get rid of answer choice C. Another one that you might be tempted by is answer choice B, which tells us that Daniel might prefer kindness over the truth. But do you notice that it doesn't say that Shayna believes that Daniel wants that? It's just about what Daniel may in fact want. We have no idea what Shayna thinks. And so if you really understood belief, you actually could pick answer choice E, because E is the only one that gets at Shayna's belief about Daniel's preference. But let's make sure we understand how answer choice E works. E says that Shayna has no opinion about whether Daniel would prefer kindness to honesty. So if she has no opinion about what Daniel prefers, then that means she does not believe he wants kindness over truth. No opinion about what he wants means that I don't know what he wants. And if I don't know what he wants, then that means I certainly don't think that he wants kindness over truth. Maybe he does want kindness over truth, but I don't currently believe that he does. And that's why we can reach the conclusion in answer choice E that she should not congratulate him, or in other words, that she should not misrepresent her feelings. Now, some of you might have thought that answer choice E is wrong because you misunderstood what it means to not be part of that exception. So sometimes what happens is when people look at this idea of do not believe the person wants kindness over truth, they actually interpret that as if Shayna believes Daniel wants truth over kindness. And so they think that because answer choice E says she has no opinion, then that means if she has no opinion, she does not believe Daniel prefers truth over kindness, and so we can't apply this principle. Now the thing is, if that's what you thought, let's take a closer look at exactly what it means to not be part of that exception. So if you look down here, I've drawn out two different possibilities. One possibility is that Shayna believes that Daniel wants kindness over truth. This is the exception. What does it mean to not fall into that exception? Or in other words, to negate the idea that she believes Daniel prefers kindness over truth. Well, it just means that she falls into this category, the category where she does not have this belief. Now, you could break down this part a little bit more. What does it mean to not believe that Daniel prefers kindness over truth? So I've broken it down a little bit further over here. If she has no opinion about what Daniel thinks, that's still going to fall into the category of not having a belief that he prefers kindness over truth. Now, it's also possible that the correct answer could have said, Shayna believes that Daniel prefers truth over kindness, because that's also going to fall into this category. But the point is that the left side here is the exception. Any of these two possibilities is going to fall into not being in that exception. So be careful about negation, because the idea of not being in this exception doesn't mean that you have to go to the other extreme and believe that Daniel wants the opposite. You also have to keep in mind the idea of just not having this affirmative belief in what he prefers. Now, the big takeaway for this problem to me is by far paying attention to the mental state associated with the principle. Not all principles will have them, but when a principle brings up belief or intent or expectation, it is almost always going to be important, especially on the difficult problems in a section. Next up is PT 74, section 1, number 10. Pause the video, try the problem on your own, and come back when you're done. This question prompt is asking us to strengthen the argument in the stimulus. There's going to be a principle which we can accept as a premise, and there's going to be an application, which in this case is a conclusion, and we want an answer that's going to help us say, yes, this principle does in fact allow us to reach this conclusion. So here's how I've broken down the principle. You can see that this principle is about expensive antiques, and it says that you should buy one of these only if you can be confident that it's the real thing and you desire it for some intrinsic value, that you're not just desiring it because you think it's a good investment. The way to get to this understanding is to recognize that that phrase only if is introducing the necessary condition. Whenever you see the phrase only if, you can actually just think of it as the arrow that points to the right. Whatever the only if is applying to, whatever's immediately after the only if, is going to be the things that is required. Now, let's make sure not to read this backwards. This principle does not mean that if you meet both of these conditions, that that automatically means you should buy it. And so to help remind me that that's not what it means, I often will take the contrapositive of a principle when the judgment is on the left side, when the judgment is on the sufficient condition. That's because it's very easy to mistakenly read this backwards. But if you make the judgment on the right side by taking the contrapositive, then that actually tells you the more proper way, the easier, more useful way to understand this principle. So here's the contrapositive, and I'll walk through the mechanical way that we get here, but I also hope that it makes conceptual sense. So here's the mechanical way to take the contrapositive. We take whatever's on the left side of the arrow, we move it to the right, and we negate it. And then we take whatever's on the right side of the arrow, and in this case, it's this and statement. We take this entire and statement, we move it to the left, and we negate it. But when you negate an and statement, you turn the and to an or, and you negate each of the concepts. So what this means is that if you can't be confident it's real, or you don't desire for intrinsic value, then you should not buy this expensive antique. And the or means that either one of these by themselves is going to be enough to say you shouldn't buy it. And so you could actually think of this or as two separate arrows like this, where this one by itself gets to not buy, and this one by itself also gets to not buy. Conceptually, I think this contrapositive should make sense, because in order for you to say that you should buy it, you need both of these things. So if you are missing even one of these two requirements, then that means you cannot buy this expensive antique. And so that's why if you're missing one or if you're missing the other, you shouldn't buy the antique. So let's consider this application. And what's happening is Mathilde is in danger of being totally ripped off, because she's considering whether to buy this expensive antique vase or vase from the internet. And we are telling her, are you insane? You should not buy it. We want to support this conclusion that she shouldn't buy it. So that means if we want to pick an answer that will help us reach this conclusion, we want an answer that meets this, that meets the sufficient condition. We want to know that she's either not confident, or rather can't be confident that it's real, or that she doesn't desire it for its intrinsic value. We want an answer that gives us at least one of these two, because that will allow us to then conclude that she shouldn't buy it. So my focus is entirely on this part of the conditional when I go through the answer choices. So if we understand what we're looking for, then answer choice A, B, C, and D should all be very easy to get rid of, because they do not tell us that she can't be confident that it's real, and they don't tell us that she doesn't desire it for its intrinsic qualities. The only answer that gives us what we want is answer choice E, because it tells us that she cannot examine the vase closely or authenticate it. That means she cannot be confident of the vase's authenticity. And that's why E is going to help us reach this conclusion. Now, one answer choice that you might find interesting is answer choice B, when it says that the seller is willing to take back the vase if Mathilde cannot independently authenticate it. But because the answer is saying if she can't authenticate it, that's not the same thing as saying that it's a fact that she can't authenticate it. And in addition, when answer choice B says that Mathilde isn't sure that it will appreciate in the future, that does suggest she cares about the investment opportunity of buying this vase. But that's not the same thing as saying she does not desire it for its intrinsic qualities. She might desire it for its intrinsic qualities as well as for its investment qualities, and B, simply saying that she seems to care about the investment is not the same as she does not desire it for its intrinsic qualities. Another answer choice you might be interested in is answer choice C, because it says that Mathilde suspects the vase will be highly desirable to other people in the future. But that's not the same thing as saying she does not desire it for its intrinsic qualities. In fact, another part of answer choice C says that she likes its shape and color, which are part of the intrinsic qualities. So that, just like answer choice B, the fact that she may have some interest, she may have some desire for the vase in part because of its investment qualities, that's not the same as saying she doesn't desire it for its intrinsic qualities. She may desire it for both. By the way, if you picked answer choice C, you may have misinterpreted this part of the principle. This part was saying one requirement in order for you to should buy it. One requirement is that you find the piece desirable for its intrinsic qualities and not just for its value as an investment. Not only for its value as an investment. So it is okay to value it for its investment, but that just can't be the only thing. That point relates to why I didn't even bother with the part about the investment when I was visualizing this principle, because if you think about it, if the requirement is you have to desire it for its intrinsic qualities and not just for its value as an investment, well, what it's saying is this is required, desiring for its intrinsic qualities. If you have this requirement, then you by definition are not desiring it only for its investment qualities. And so there really is no extra information, no extra important information with the investment part of this principle. And so I'm only focusing on what is actually required, which is desiring it for its intrinsic value. So the big takeaways from this problem are: make sure you understand what only if means. It introduces a necessary condition. And make sure you understand that when you take the contrapositive of a conditional statement that has an and, you have to change the and to an or, as well as negate each of those terms.